Well, good afternoon and welcome to all of you as we gather as this community to remember the passion and death of our Lord and to thank the Father for the gift of his Son, and the Son for the gift of his life for us.
Okay.
So I invite you to follow the service in the booklets that you've received. And just as a reminder that the offering that we receive today will be for St. Vincent de Paul Society, headquartered in Batavia at Holy Cross Church. And the St. Vincent de Paul Society does a lot, especially around issues of housing for those who are most in need. So we want to thank you in advance for your generosity and for your faithful presence here today. And invite you then to please stand as you're able and join in the opening hymn.
In the cross of Christ, thy glory towering o'er the wrecks of time, all the light of sacred story gathers round its head sublime. When the walls of life o'ertake me, hopes deceive and fears annoy, never shall the cross forsake me. Lo, it glows with joy. When the sun of bliss is beaming light and love upon my way, from the cross the radiance streaming adds more luster to the day. Bane and blessing, pain and pleasure, by the cross are sanctified. Peace is there that knows no measure, joys that through all time abide.
Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. The abundant grace and mercy of God be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, look with loving mercy on your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed, to be given over to the hands of sinners, and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Please be seated.
Good afternoon. A reading from St. Luke. When they came to the place that is called the skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
that line, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." That line could be the defining line that describes humanity through all times and places. Forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing. In some ways, we don't like to hear that, being honest. We don't like to admit to our shortcomings. We don't like to admit to the fact that we are sinful in nature, that we don't love one another as we have been loved. We don't welcome one another as we have been welcomed. But the truth is, all you have to do is watch. Watch the news, or maybe don't. Watch the internet, or maybe don't. The fact is, human nature is to divide. Human nature is to create barriers. Human nature is to judge. Human nature is to try to play God every chance that we get. And then we see Jesus on a cross, in pain and agony, suffering mightily, taking on the sin of the world, all of it, for all of us, on his heart.
His heart.
And in that,
and in that moment of great suffering
and great,
great physical
really
pain,
be careful.
The words that come to mind for Jesus are, "Father, forgive them." He shows mercy. He shows grace. In the moment of his greatest anguish and pain. For one, we can take that as reassurance to each of us as individuals, to know that we are loved, we are cared for, the mercy and grace is for all of us, no matter what we've done and what we will do. But there's a second part to that as well. We are the body of Christ in this world. We are called upon to try our best to be Christ-like for those who meet us. We are called upon to be agents of mercy and grace in our best moments and in our worst, in our greatest joy and in our worst suffering. We are to reflect these words, "Father, forgive them." We are to pray for others. We are to welcome others. We are to love others. We are to be a beacon of Christ's light. And never forget that in that moment, on the cross, surrounded by the worst darkness of the world, worst evil the world had to give, the light still shone into our darkness with love and mercy. There was nothing, nothing that could ever put out that light. Be that light and know that regardless of where we have been, where we are going, what we have done and what we will do. Jesus' prayer is always, forgive them. His desire is always, love them. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Lord, as we gather this day, we grieve. We grieve for the pain that we have put you through. But we also know that in all of that pain, your instinct is to love us, forgive us, and call us. We give thanks for this day, especially for this day, for the way in which you showed faith towards us, love towards us, and mercy towards us. Bless us now to be a reflection of those same traits and attributes. We pray this in your holy name. Amen.
A reading from St. Luke. One of the criminals who were hanged there kept deriding him and saying, "Are you not the Messiah? Save yourself and save us." But the other rebuked him, saying, "Do you not fear God, since you are under the same sentence of condemnation, and we indeed have been condemned justly, for we are getting what we deserve for our deeds, but this man has done nothing wrong." Then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus replied, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." The word of God, the word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus is hung between two criminals who are being put to death for their crimes. We, the listeners of this story, we know that Jesus is the Messiah, the promised one, because we live now this side of the story. We know that Jesus is the one now who comes to redeem us, who calls us into right relationship with the holy. He was sent to earth for that very purpose, to show us what it is like and what it looks like to embody the holy in our lives. How can that be a crime? But all the first criminal sees in Jesus is what Jesus potentially can do for him. He heckles, "Aren't you the Christ? Then save me!" He is only interested in what Jesus can do for him on a transactional level. He wants a transactional relationship with the holy. what's in it for me? He's probably lived his whole life this way, and now, even at the end of his death, he is still looking at relationships as transactional. What's in it for me? The other criminal, possibly having done the same or similar crimes, sees it differently. He has some sense of self-awareness, enough to know that the penalty he is enduring is just. His choices have led him to this place that he finds himself in. But there is something in him that he realizes, it may not be too late for me to be made right. He humbles himself. He makes himself vulnerable. And he confesses with his words the belief that he has realized in his heart while hanging there next to Jesus, and says, "You are the, this is the one." And really, that's all it takes, is for you to realize it, humble yourself, confess it, make yourself vulnerable, and you will be restored. It's a simple message. And we know this because even in the story, in that moment, he is promised paradise. In that very moment. So, the truth is same for us, all of us who are gathered here today, who struggle to embody the life of Jesus, who embody the holy, who struggle with what it means to live an embodied life of holiness. That life that Jesus shown us so many years ago is accessible to us today. Even though, as was mentioned earlier, it is a very hard and difficult life to do on a daily and weekly and monthly and yearly basis. Because a holy life requires us to be kind, to welcome the stranger, to put others' interests ahead of our own needs. And a life, it's a life that calls us, and we know it's going to be a glorious one because we know Easter is coming, this side of the story. But still, it is hard. It is hard because of all the things that pull at us, the news, the internet, right? It's hard because it can be exhausting, this life we lead. It can consume us. The life of everydayness. Our human life can sometimes require us to put a relationship over other relationships. It can pit us against each other. It can cause us to shrink and hide away from each other and not come out and be present. This life can also make us sometimes hurt the people we love the most. And it requires that we at times ask for them to forgive us. This life can make us bitter and jaded. And yet, we are reminded today that the promise is given that if we confess the truth within our hearts, that we humble ourselves, we make ourselves vulnerable to one another and to the holy, that we will be restored. In an instant. Friends, years ago, I avoided this call to ministry. Actually, it took me decades to hear this call. I was convinced in my heart, you see, that God surely could not, would not be interested in somebody like me. A person that my family had labeled the black sheep of the family. A person who had many, I hate to say, skeletons in my closet. But then something happened, and I'm not really proud of this, but a minister friend of mine, nobody sitting here, shared with me some of the things in their past life. And what they told me were things that I had imagined were deal breakers with God. And that's the part I'm really not that proud of, that I was judging of that person. But it turns out the things I thought were deal breakers for God aren't. She was somebody I looked up to, somebody whose sermons I felt spoke to me when I was sitting in the pew. And what I realized, again, not so proud of this, but if God could forgive her and God could use her in such a powerful way in my life, then maybe, just maybe, God was also calling me. What I realized in that moment is that God is more gracious and forgiving than I am. Things I had been led to believe that were deal breakers for God, it turns out, like I said, weren't. I came to know and believe that nothing I had done in my past could separate me from the love of God, as long as I came to realize that, confess that, humble myself, I too could be restored. So friends, the message is nothing can separate us. Even criminals and thieves can be restored to right relationship with the holy. And so can we on a daily, weekly, and monthly basis. May it be so. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious, loving, most kind, and generous God, you know us and you know our hearts. You know those things we need to confess. And we ask that you receive our confessions now. You receive our vulnerabilities now. And that you restore us to a relationship with the holy. Amen.
Reading from St. John. Meanwhile, near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother. And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
When death draws near, it seems a nearly universal human instinct to be close to those that we love. It's part of what was most painful about the COVID pandemic, was it not? I'm sure there are stories here of those that we could not be with in their final hours, though we desperately wanted to be there. But there's a push and pull to it, isn't there? We both really want to be there near the person that we love, the family member. But it's also a very, very hard place to be. We might rather be any other place than there. We do this for family. Some are called to do it beyond their family. There was a young woman named Jackie, around my age. She passed away a few years ago. Health issues that she was dealing with had her living in a nursing home when she was in her 30s, with people who were decades older than her. And she loved people. She loved them well. She loved her roommates. She loved her friends down the hall. And some of these folks, decades older than her, would be nearing the end of their life. And she felt a call from God to be there with them in their final hours. So in between hospice visits, or in between family visits, there Jackie would sit, being a loving, caring presence, because she didn't want them to be alone. That's part of the pain of the cross, isn't it? That Jesus was abandoned by those who should have been there. They fled in his moment of greatest need. They denied even knowing him. But here on the cross, Jesus looks out and his eyes scan the crowd, and he looks around and he sees the faces of his accusers. He sees the faces of his abusers. He sees the passers-by who joined in the mocking. He sees them dividing his clothes for sport. But he also sees some sympathetic faces, doesn't he? Some familiar faces. Depending on how you count it, three, maybe four women who were gathered there. Mary, the wife of Clopas, Mary Magdalene, and Mary, his own mother. Of course she was there. What a difficult place that must have been for her to be. And yet, of course, she would be there. She couldn't not be there. Mary forms the bookends of Jesus' life, does she not? Mary, the mother of Jesus, she was there at the very beginning, saying yes to the unbelievable plan of God to bring his love into this world. Mary, who sang boldly of the will of God to tear down the mighty and lift up the humble. Mary, who in John 2 is seen prodding her son along, come on, it's time to go public. It's time to make a sign known here at this wedding in Cana. And now here, at the end of Jesus' life, in a place of unbelievable, unspeakable grief, she stands here to see her son brutalized and tortured and killed. Some of you here know the singular grief of losing a child. I've been told it's something you cannot understand until you've gone through it. Yet none of us, I believe, can understand the grief that Mary must have felt in this moment. For she was there as mother, yes, but she was also there as disciple. She was there, this was not only her son, but also her Savior. Not only her child, but her Lord. She beheld Jesus' crucifixion with the eyes of faith. Yes, the eyes of a mother and the eyes of faith. Having gathered up all the incredible things that she had seen and beheld from Jesus' birth on through his life. And now she's here, standing in faith. Mary, the mother and disciple of Jesus, is joined by another who's known by his relationship to Jesus. We know him in John as the disciple Jesus loved. How wonderful to be known as the disciple that Jesus loved. Perhaps John, perhaps another disciple. If John, here at the foot of the cross, then he evidently worked through the fear and panic that he felt the night before in the garden when he fled with the other disciples. But regardless, here he is at the foot of the cross, beholding the pain and love of his Savior. These two disciples, known primarily for their love for Jesus and Jesus' love for them, they did not want their beloved to be left alone. So their love drew them to this painful place where they stood, where they waited, where they cried and stood in pain. And in that place, words from the cross: "Woman, here is your son. Here is your mother." You see, they had come in grief to be close to him, to be a support to him, so that he would not face death alone. But here Jesus speaks words that reveal the blessing that God had for, or that Jesus and God had for them, even in his pain. He speaks words of care for them, care for his mother, ensuring that her needs would be taken care of. He speaks words of comfort for this disciple, ensuring that he would be nurtured and guided in his faith. As we come together to the cross today, can we look to our left and our right for a moment? Go ahead. See the people who have gathered here as well, at the foot of the cross, to behold the pain and suffering and love of the one who's loved us so perfectly. We're all drawn here together by the unfailing love of our Savior. Now, we'll celebrate on Sunday that Jesus' death was not an ending. No, it was the beginning of new life. But we don't have to wait until Sunday to behold that. Because here at the foot of the cross, Jesus is birthing something new. He's creating a new reality. A new family is coming into being. You see, he's given his mother and this disciple each other, to care for and support, to love and face the griefs and sorrows of this life together, to stand as a waiting and watching witness that God is able to do far beyond what we could ask or imagine. He's given us one another to watch over, to care for each other, to give one another courage to stand at the foot of the cross. We're called to care for one another, not in any patronizing or paternalizing way, but respectfully, tenderly, as a mother cares for a son, as a son cares for a mother. He says to them, as he said to his disciples, as he says to us, "Take care of each other. A new commandment I give you, that you should love one another. As I've done for you, so you must do for one another. Wash each other's feet." As a family of God, I find this particularly poignant today as we gather from different churches, from different traditions. For at our church, we often talk about being a family, our congregation. But is it not true that we are drawn together as a family beyond the walls of our congregations? We are called to stand together, holding one another up in hope in our Savior Jesus. Just as my friend Jackie did at the bedside of her friends, just as Mary and these disciples did at the foot of the cross of Christ, so we are empowered to stand together and to encounter the crosses of this world, the places that are uncomfortable, the places that we would probably rather not be except for the love of Jesus compelling us to be there. We're called to come together in confident and patient hope, believing and what God can do, believing that Jesus is who he says he is. In the face of the unjust violence of this world, together we stand, waiting, patiently, refusing to engage in violence, but waiting to bear witness to God bringing his kingdom to this world. Waiting patiently, holding one another up, as we stand against the powers that would destroy the plan of God. With love and mutuality as our guide, living together as the reconstituted family of God, centered on the cross of Christ, our Savior and Lord. By our very presence, we bear witness to what God has done, what he is doing, and what he will do. We show the world that God has come, that sin is defeated, that resurrection is coming. And so we stand, and we grieve, and we wait for the restoration of God together. Would you pray with me? our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, you have loved us in unmistakable, unrelenting, unprecedented ways. Bind us together in your love, O God, that we might be for this world a sign of your goodness, a sign of your hope, a sign of your care. And all God's people said, Amen.
A reading from St. Mark. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3:00, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
2 weeks ago, Sunday, I did something I've been thinking about doing for quite some time, but hadn't had the guts to try. Do you remember the old National Public Radio show, Car Talk, with Click and Clack, the Tappet brothers? They answered all your questions about car care and repair with expertise and insight and humor. It was fantastic radio. Anyway, they regularly had a segment they called Stump the Chump, in which they invited their callers to present them with the most mysterious, unanswerable car questions they had, the noise that couldn't be located, or the leak that wouldn't be plugged. Anyway, that's what I did, only in terms of theology. I invited the members of the Congregational Church of Batavia to write down their most pressing faith questions, anything about the Bible or church history or theology, and put them in a basket, and I would do my best to answer them there on the spot as part of Sunday's sermon. Now, to be clear, I don't think that I'm some kind of doctrinal wunderkind who can answer any question about God and the universe that anyone might put forth. Far from it, in fact. I'm just a person with a whole lot of questions myself and a seminary education, which anyone who has had one will tell you is insufficient at best. That is the nature of things. We cannot fully know the infinite. But that said, I wanted to provide folks with a safe place to ask those questions that were on their hearts and their minds, to remind them that doubts are not a failure of faith, but a part of the process of growth and evolution. So I collected their questions in a basket, and I had 12 total. And here's the interesting thing. Of those 12 questions, half of them were about why there is suffering and pain and violence and evil and death in the world, right? And these are some of the actual questions folks wrote down. Why is there so much suffering in the world? Where do we find God in global tragedy? If we are to believe that God is omnipotent, then why is there so much evil and suffering in our world? Half of the questions I received were in this vein. And to be perfectly honest, I don't have an answer. I don't know why there's suffering and pain and violence and evil and death in the world. And even if I did have an answer, I sincerely doubt that it would be a satisfying one. I mean, we talked about this in seminary, I know everybody did, as well as in my philosophy minor in college, but I never found any of the explanations that were offered there to be particularly constructive. And that might be because I think the question that people are really asking is less about why these things happen in the world, but rather more about what the maker of all things intends to do about it. We aren't so much looking for the reasons, but for a response, a reckoning, a rescue, if you will. And that's the heart of our question, isn't it? It certainly is the heart of Jesus' anguished cry on the cross when he quotes Psalm 22, my God, why have you forsaken me? And ironically, it is in this moment of Jesus' life that I find the comfort and the hope and the answer that I'd been looking for when I ask myself that question, why? To be sure, it's not the complete answer that will come in 3 days' time. But it certainly is a part of the answer, and a vital one at that. Because of the core beliefs of the Christian faith, one of them is that somehow, through some miracle we can't possibly understand, God took on flesh and blood and bone in the person of Jesus Christ. That somehow through some miracle we can glimpse the essence and the nature of God through him. And what is it that I glimpse of the divine as Jesus hangs on the cross and cries out in pain and anger and desperation? I see a God who chooses to be with us in our own suffering, who chooses to walk beside us through the valley of the shadow of death, who chooses to hold our hand lest we faint. Now, does that make the darkness and the pain and the struggle disappear? No, it does not. But it does make it bearable until resurrection comes. We have a name for that in our faith, and it is grace. So for the grace of God, which promises that we will never journey alone, not through the good, not through the bad, not through the worst, we give thanks on this Good Friday. Amen. If your heart is willing, please join me in a moment of prayer. God of infinite love, on this day when we remember the suffering death of your Son and our brother Jesus Christ, we take a strange comfort in knowing that in him, you not only participate in our suffering, but actively and intentionally journey through it with us, so that we will never be alone in the dark. For this sign, for this hope, for this grace, we thank you today. Amen.
Save with them now, Lord, and with grief and shame, wait. A reading from St. John. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I'm thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so he put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
I'm Melissa Myers. I'm the pastor at Batavia United Methodist Church and newly to Batavia, having just come here in July. And as part of being here, my niece and my nephew wanted to explore the city with us. So they spent a weekend with us. And they love spending time, especially with me, but because Aunt Missy doesn't say no. And so we had a weekend adventure. We went swimming, we went to the car show, we went all over the place. And we were ending one of our evenings at the Batavia Creamery for a sweet treat. And when we finished, we were getting back in the car to drive the 5, maybe 3 minutes home. And before my niece even buckled her car seat, she said, "Can we stop at McDonald's and get something to drink?" She's 5. And her brother said to her, "Can't you wait like 5 minutes until we get home?" And with all of the drama in her little body, she said, "Do you not understand? This is a thirsty emergency." And I said, "Who am I to argue with a thirsty emergency?" And her brother said, "I don't think that's a real thing." And she said, "Oh, it is, and it's happening." So we stopped and got an orange drink from her, which she drank 2 sips. And as we were finishing the rest of the 2-minute drive home, her brother said, "You know, she just thinks that she's cool because you let her have a sugary drink before bed." And she looked at him and she said, "I am cool." Who am I to argue with a thirsty emergency? I mean, when was the last time that you had a thirsty emergency? When you just had to have something right that minute because you were thirsty? And when that beverage hit your lips, was it satisfying? Did it quench that thirsty emergency? Did you feel cool? Jesus said, "I thirst." Now, Jesus often said things and people took him literally when he didn't mean something literally, and also said things that people didn't take literally when maybe he might have meant it. I mean, we don't have that problem today. We all accurately interpret Jesus today, right? We're all good. And we all do that the same. Right. So, maybe things haven't changed. Jesus said these things. You know, there's the story of Jesus meeting a woman at the well. It's found in the Gospel of John. And in their interaction, Jesus offered her living water, and she wanted it. She wanted that actual water so that she didn't have to come to the well anymore. She was thirsty for it. Might have been a thirsty emergency. Also in the Gospel of John, Jesus' first miracle or sign was turning water into wine at a wedding. He told the servers, "Fill up those jars with water." And that might have been a thirsty emergency. Or what about when Jesus came to John the Baptist and asked to be baptized in the river, not necessarily to drink the water, but to be submerged in it? I mean, was that a thirsty emergency? Oh, and there's the healings. When Jesus spat on the ground, or at the pool of Siloam, were those in need of healings? Were those thirsty emergencies? As Jesus is on the cross, is he dehydrated? Well, probably. Is his soul tired? Probably. Is this a thirsty emergency? Probably. Are you tired? Are you weary? Are you thirsty? Probably. Now, I know thirsty means something a little different today, especially if you ask a teenager what thirsty means. It's usually a desperation for attention. And while I don't necessarily mean that, also, what is in desperate need of attention? Is there anything that you're thirsty for? Are you thirsty for peace? That might be a thirsty emergency. Are you thirsty for justice? That might be a thirsty emergency. Are you thirsty for grace? Are you thirsty for forgiveness? Are you thirsty for healing? That might be thirsty emergencies. Jesus said, I thirst. And every day we say the same. And sometimes in our desire to end our thirsty emergency, we sometimes pick the easy way. Not always the water, but the vinegar. It doesn't quench the thirsty emergency. And yet, we have the hope and the relief. For when the living water quenches our thirsty emergency, and we believe that that living water will come, I thirst. The story of Jesus isn't over. There's more to tell. There's more to live. There are more thirsty emergencies. And we're invited into this story over and over and over again. Taste this living water. Are you thirsty for it? May we be the miracle and answers to one another's prayers in our own thirsty emergencies. May we share the hope of living water. May we be peacemakers. May we work for justice. May we offer forgiveness and reconciliations. May the thirsty emergencies find rescue. Amen.
Thank you. by the vault whose dark abode held in vain the rising God. Oh, from earth to heaven restored, mighty, re-ascended Lord, bending from your throne on high, hear our penitential cry.
A reading from St. John. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." And then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Word of God, word of life, thanks be to God. Almost 100 years ago, C.S. Lewis wrote a book about love, and he said that the diagram for love was this. And that's what we are about today, an incredible moment of love. As Melissa was just saying, Jesus is thirsty, and a hyssop is lifted to him with sour wine on it, and that takes us all the way back to the moment in Egypt when the Israelites in captivity and bondage and enslaved, in that moment of their freedom, they take a branch of hyssop and they dip it in the blood of an innocent animal, and then they are told to place that blood on the lintel of their house. And in that moment, they draw the diagram of love. And then they are set free from the enemy of death. And we come to this moment of Jesus' death, and his word to us is a word of triumph, actually. It's not a sigh of relief, and it's not a moment of despair. It's a word that captures his courage and fulfillment when he says, "It is finished." In the Greek, we say three words there, "it is finished," but in the Greek, it's much more developed. It is finished and will be forever complete. What's he describing there? It's that diagram of love, his blood for you and me. You see that? That word in the Greek, it's tetelestai, and it has a very specific meaning for the people of that time and place. You see, when someone had committed a crime, an offense, and they were guilty and shamed by their wrong deeds, there was a sentence, and then they were placed into the jail. So it could be a moment that Melissa just spoke. So I could have come and attacked Melissa and taken her purse. And in that moment, I'm found guilty in the courtroom for my wrongs. And I serve a sentence. And every now and then they find the little tablets that have that word, tetelestai, written on it, that were given to the prisoner as he'd completed his sentence. And you know why they were given that tablet? Because if the wronged person saw them on the street, they could be accused again of the crime. And they could offer proof that the jailer had given them, that they'd been set free, that they no longer were in bondage for all the wrongs they had done, and in that moment of accusation, and we all have accusers. Probably, especially ourselves. In that moment of accusation, you could take out the little tablet and you could say, "It is finished. It is complete and forever." And in that moment, the diagram of love being written, Jesus says, for you and me and over us, a cry of triumph, "It is finished." Let us pray. Help us, Lord, to be still. Help us to be still and know that you are God and that you have set us free through the love you show us on the hard wood of the cross. In your holy name, amen.
A reading from St. Luke. It was now about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m, while the sun's light failed, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Then Jesus, crying with a loud voice, said, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Having said this, he breathed his last. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
On April 19th, 1775, at the Battle of Lexington and Concord, there was the proverbial shot heard around the world. Who fired first? The British? The Americans? Nobody knows. Nobody will ever know. But the shot had world historic consequences. We now have two countries. We now have America. This afternoon, in the shadow of the cross, we will think likewise about the sentence heard around the world, the breath heard around the world, the death and the love. So first, the sentence heard around the world. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Jesus' words here are rightly famous last words, but they're not even his own words. If you follow the footnote in your Bible, it says this actually comes from the Psalms, Psalm 31:5. There, David expresses his sure trust that God will save him from his wartime enemies. And here, Jesus takes these words and applies them to his final breath. This is interesting because it kind of defeats the purpose of the original saying, right? Like Jesus is not having victory over his wartime enemies. He's being killed when he says this. God evidently has not saved this speaker, Jesus, from his enemies. But what Jesus does is he repositions the quotation so that now death itself is the enemy. Jesus trusts God to conquer, not over his earthly enemies, but over death itself. So in this new setting, as Jesus says this from the cross, it means, I'm going to die. My soul is going to leave my body. So God, receive me into the afterlife. This is a statement that speaks to our finite nature, that we are going to die, and that we need to trust God as we exit everything we have ever known and sojourn ahead. Second, the breath heard around the world. The spirit that Jesus commends to his Father is not just any spirit, it is the Holy Spirit, the spirit that the Father bestowed upon him at his baptism, the same spirit that 3 days later will resurrect Jesus from the dead, and in 50 more days will descend upon the church in fire to empower them to fearlessly preach the gospel and to live renewed lives. That same spirit is our spirit of adoption, Romans tells us, our tether as Gentiles to the God of Israel, nowhere else. And finally, the same spirit is our comforter, John tells us. It is the one who will guide us into all truth in time enough. But third, this is also the death heard around the world. Jesus' death, when he dies, there's an impossible solar eclipse during a full moon. If you think about this, this is not possible. You cannot have both a solar eclipse and a full moon at the same time. So how can this be? Well, there's actually a scribal tradition of trying to minimize this. So there's a translation variant, and in the text I read, it says, the sun's light failed. Right, this is people over the centuries trying to minimize the miracle here, but do not minimize the miracle. It is significant that it is impossible for it to happen, and yet it happens at no time other than Jesus' death on the cross. At the exact same moment as the impossible astral phenomenon, we have the temple's curtain being torn in two. How this can be, we do not know either. But the point is that both are happening at once, and both are happening at Jesus' death on the cross. In other words, at the epicenter of the universe, the temple, something happened that affected out the entire cosmos. Or as Paul put it in 2 Corinthians, in Christ, God is reconciling the world to himself. Jesus saves and redeems all things, redeeming not only our bodies, but also all bodies in nature and even nature itself. Fourth, the love heard around the world. Jesus' death is recognized immediately for what it really was. The centurion is standing across from him, and he says, surely, this man is innocent. And the thief on the cross next to him said, surely, this man is innocent. God's gift of his son was not a death as usual, since Jesus deserved none of it, but instead, it expresses for us the incredible richness of God's love. This is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his son to be an atoning sacrifice for our sins, 1 John tells us. To know that we are loved, that we are desired, to the extent that God would absolutely do anything necessary to save us and to have us as his own. This love breaks and remakes our understanding of love. We cannot love the same way, again, knowing God's love for us in Christ. And if he loved us enough to save us by his son, then he will also love us enough to guide us into his presence on that final day. This love, then, gives us confidence to say with Jesus, Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. These things we say in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
As I mentioned at the beginning, the offering for today will go to the St. Vincent de Paul Society, headquartered at Holy Cross Church here in Batavia, for assisting all those with various housing needs. And again, encourage your generosity. Let us pray. God of mercy,
you bless us with gifts that sustain our lives. You transform us with the priceless gift of grace. Receive us and these signs of your blessings, and may our fasting, prayer, and works of love be an offering of thanksgiving for all that you have done for us in Christ our Lord. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.